In this subunit, we're going to look at the prisoner's dilemma, which is perhaps the earliest idea model for studying cooperation in social science and political science, among other fields. The prisoner's dilemma is based on a metaphorical story. So here's the story. Alice and Bob have collaborated on committing a crime, and they've been caught and thrown in jail. They're not allowed to talk to each other. There's no possible way that they can communicate. And the police are offering a deal that involves one testifying against the other. The police don't have quite enough evidence to convict them on the charge they want to convict them on, so they're going to try to get one of them to testify against the other one. Here's the deal. If neither of them testify, then the police are going to have to reduce the charge and each one will get 5 years in prison. However, if Alice decides to keep silent, but Bob decides to testify against her, Alice is going to get life in prison, and Bob is going to go free. The same applies to Bob. If he keeps silent, but Alice testifies, he gets life in prison, and Alice goes free. Now, if they both testify against each other, they're each going to get 10 years in prison. They're both offered the exact same deal. With no communication, they have to decide what to do. So should they stay silent or testify? What would you do if you were Alice? Here's how Alice's thought process might go. Suppose Bob keeps silent. If she keeps silent, she'll get 5 years in prison, and if she testifies, she gets off scot-free. So in that case, she should clearly testify. Now suppose Bob testifies. Well, in that case, if Alice keeps silent, she gets life in prison. And if she testifies, she gets 10 years in prison, which is better than life in prison. So she should testify in that case as well. The only problem is that Bob is going through the same thought process and concludes that in each case he should testify. So what happens is they both decide to testify and they both get 10 years in prison. Whereas they would have only gotten 5 years in prison if they had only cooperated with each other and kept silent. The question is, what could have convinced them to stay silent? The prisoner's dilemma was originally invented by two mathematical game theorists, Flood and Drescher, in the 1950s, at the height of the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union. It's been used as a metaphor for real-world cooperation issues in arms races, wars, global warming, and many other phenomena. It's also one of the most famous and influential idea models in social science. If you're a social scientist, I'm guessing you've probably heard of it. We can gauge a little bit of its fame and influence by looking on the Google Scholar page, and The Prisoner's Dilemma gets 34,000 results. A version of it discussed by Garrett Hardin has been famously called the tragedy of the commons. The tragedy is that it's always in an individual's best interest to not cooperate, but if everyone does not cooperate, then everyone gets a worse result. In the words of political scientist Robert Axelrod, the pursuit of self-interest by each leads to a poor outcome for all. Robert Axelrod is a political science professor at the University of Michigan who has been studying the prisoner's dilemma and variants of it for over 30 years. He's written two very influential books on this topic, one called The Evolution of Cooperation and the second called The Complexity of Cooperation. According to Axelrod, his main motivation for learning about effective strategies was to find out how cooperation could be promoted in international politics, especially between the East and the West during the Cold War. And his main question is, under what conditions will cooperation emerge in a world of egoists without central authority? And this remains, of course, an extremely important question today. When scientists study the prisoner's dilemma, they typically phrase it in terms of a game with two players. So our two players are Bob and Alice. And Bob and Alice decide to either cooperate, which would correspond in our story to staying quiet, so they're cooperating with each other, or defecting, That would correspond to testifying against the other one. They receive what's called a payoff. The payoff is given by this payoff matrix. Now here, we're going to depart from our prisoner story and we're going to assume that the higher the payoff, the better. In this payoff matrix, if Alice and Bob both cooperate, then Alice, here in red, gets 3 points and Bob gets 3 points. If Alice cooperates and Bob defects, Alice gets 0, Bob gets 5. If Alice defects and Bob cooperates, the opposite happens. Alice gets 5 and Bob gets 0, and they each get 1 point if they both defect. So these numbers aren't the same as in our prisoner's story, but the idea is the same. Alice can reason that if Bob cooperates, the best thing for her to do is to defect, and if Bob defects, the best thing for her to do is defect. So in both cases, Alice will decide to defect. Again, the goal is to get as many points as possible, regardless of what the other player gets. So this is not a competitive game. It's about individuals trying to maximize their own payoff. On one round, each player either cooperates or defects, and there's no prior communication between the two players. Axelrod's question was this. Suppose that the game is iterated. That is, the players play for several rounds, remembering perhaps what the other player did on previous rounds. How is it possible that reciprocal cooperation can be induced? To study this question, Axelrod devised 2 tournaments in which he invited well-known political scientists, other social scientists, mathematicians, game theorists to submit strategies to play against one another. The strategies played iterated games against one another in a round-robin fashion, that is, each individual played against every other individual and played several games against every other individual. Some people submitted very complicated strategies that created complex statistical models of other opponents and did quite a bit of computation. These strategies were all given as computer programs. And it turned out that the winner of both of the tournaments was the simplest of all the strategies, known as tit for tat, which is submitted by Anatole Rapoport, mathematician. What tit for tat does is it starts out by cooperating, and then at each successive round, it just does what the other player did on the previous round. So if the other player cooperated on the previous round, tit for tat cooperates. If the other player defected on the previous round, tit for tat defects. So it rewards cooperation with cooperation, and it punishes defection with defection. Incredibly simple, but it was the winner. The NetLogo Models Library has a number of Prisoner's Dilemma models. We're going to look at 2 of them, but before we do that, I'm going to have you take a quiz to make sure you understand what we've done so far in this subunit.